Welcome to East Fortune Hospital, or at least what's left of it. This massive site, located near North Berwick in Scotland, has long since fallen into ruin. What were once bustling wards and offices are now empty shells, gradually falling to pieces as the years tick by. By now, decades after it last welcomed a patient, the hospital has come to look decidedly spooky. So what happened? Why has East Fortune been left to rot? And are there any ghosts from its long and venerable past still lurking in its ruins? East Fortune started life during the First World War. Back then, it wasn't a hospital, but rather a naval air station where an assortment of balloons and dirigibles were serviced and launched. This was many years before the Hindenburg bit the dust, and gadding about in balloons was still considered pretty futuristic. Indeed, history was well and truly made when the state-of-the-art R-34 airship was launched from East Fortune in 1919. Several days, and several near-death experiences later, that same airship touched down in America, having completed the first ever east-to-west aerial crossing of the Atlantic Ocean. No mean feat, and all the more incredible when you find out that upon arrival, they had just 1 hour of fuel left in the tank. That wasn't all they had, though. Two stowaways were discovered during the journey, a cute little kitten named Whoopsie, and a much less cute airman named William Ballantyne, who'd snuck on board in order to be part of the record-breaking flight. It was a brave shot at immortality, and given that we're still talking about him more than 100 years later, it sort of worked. Good for you, William. The R-34 was a triumph of engineering, and undoubtedly a very cool airship. But however cool blimps were, there just wasn't that much call for them after the war came to an end. Indeed, the R-34 was scrapped just 2 years after its record-breaking flight, when it got into a slow-motion fender bender and couldn't be repaired. So what to do with East Fortune Airfield? Given that the war had just ended, humanity was in pretty rough shape. Not only were there many, many injuries from the fighting, but disease was also rampant. Tuberculosis, a nasty little bacterial infection that often targets the lungs, was running wild, and medical professionals were a bit stuck for ideas on how to treat it. While curing tuberculosis was easier said than done, it did seem to help if you isolated people who had it, ideally in a place with a good amount of fresh air. This not only helped manage the spread of the disease, but it was also thought to give sufferers the best chance of recovering. In 1922, therefore, East Fortune Airfield became East Fortune Sanatorium, welcoming 210 men and women with tuberculosis. That was also when these charming verandas were added. As well as fresh air, a measured amount of sunlight each day was thought to be beneficial, and the verandas provided the perfect way to give patients just the right dose of sunshine, without giving them sunburn. Sunburn isn't usually something you have to worry about in Scotland, by the way, but better safe than sorry. Another belief going about at the time was the idea that tuberculosis was spread by cats, and it wasn't uncommon to spot a few stray kitties lingering around the hospital, descendants of Whoopsie the stowaway, perhaps. Whenever the medical superintendent spotted one on the grounds, he would at once summon help. "Sister," he was often heard to cry. "The shotgun." An alarming command to hear in a medical context. The sister would of course fetch the shotgun, and the superintendent would open the nearest window, point the 12 bore at the offending feline, and then politely ask it to leave the premises, probably. That's just one example of the strict discipline that was enforced at East Fortune in its earlier years. The care provided was firm and no nonsense. Indeed, one patient, who dared complain about the lunch he was served, was sent home in an ambulance that very same day, despite the fact that he was still in a full body cast. Maybe that sounds a bit harsh, but as long as you didn't complain about the cooking, life was actually pretty good at East Fortune. Most patients were there for long spells, and there were tuberculosis sufferers of all ages at the sanatorium. To keep their spirits up during their long spells of convalescence, patients would put on plays, arrange ward parties, and stage talent contests. Thanks to some connections arranged by a former patient, they also enjoyed a fair few celebrity visits and private concerts, including a meet and greet with Tom Mix, Hollywood's first Western film star. Of course, everything changed at East Fortune during the Second World War. The RAF swooped back in and took over once more, with the hospital's patients shifted to the nearby Bangor Village Hospital and the sanatorium's furniture and equipment chucked into storage. Several large huts and other buildings were added, and the whole place was redecorated for the serious business of war. It was 1949 before the site was handed back, at which time returning medical staff were appalled to find that the good folk of the RAF had scuffed up the wooden floors, spilled beer everywhere, and covered the walls in lewd graffiti, most of which was swiftly sanded into oblivion. Treatment of tuberculosis sufferers continued, but thanks to advances in medical science, TB was on the way out. As years went by, fewer and fewer TB patients occupied the wards, and so the hospital became dedicated to the care of people with learning disabilities, and later, to those recovering from other illnesses. During these post-war years, the hospital was a bustling and decidedly happy place to be. There were many patients, plenty going on, and a village-like atmosphere. It had its own magazine, a strong community, and was generally considered the place to be for the best in modern healthcare. But time marched on. Other, more modern health facilities opened their doors, and in 1997, East Fortune was finally closed. The last few patients were transferred away, and the place was shuttered for the final time, with much of the furniture and equipment left in situ. The question of what to do with the site was a difficult one. As many of the buildings dated back to the early 1900s, they were rife with asbestos, making them a dangerous and expensive nightmare to demolish or convert for other uses. So instead of being demolished or converted, East Fortune was simply left. Over the decades, weather and vandals and nature took their toll, gradually breaking the once majestic site down into a shell-like ruin, and a very eerie one at that. Now East Fortune is frequented mainly by adventurous teens, urban explorers, and people on the hunt for a spooky-looking photo opportunity. The site is festooned with signs warning of the dangers of asbestos, but they don't seem to have driven off visitors altogether. There are some plans to turn the grounds into a village, but it'll be years yet before there's any concrete developments. In the meantime, East Fortune Sanatorium, once a thriving community, will continue to quietly moulder away in the countryside year on year. The abandoned site does occasionally make the papers, but usually for the creepy things that are found there, rather than its long and interesting history. And that's understandable, as there is a higher than average number of eyeless dolls to be found scattered around the place. When you know the history of the site, though, it's hard to see it as creepy. This was a place that helped many thousands of people, and the memories that most people have of it are, broadly speaking, fond ones. So while East Fortune might look like a thoroughly haunted location, we can't help but think it's actually rather peaceful.